Second member's motion. Motion under the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance. Members who wish to speak on the motion will please press the request to speak button. I now call upon Ms. Claudia MO to speak and move the motion. Mr. Claudia MO. President, I move that the motion as printed on the agenda be passed. President, the administration chose to announce the consultation of the on constitution reform. Perhaps it's hoping, therefore, the free TV license issue, which caused such an uproar, now nobody would care about it. But look, I'm not going to call for quorum, President, don't worry. Or perhaps I should call quorum. Call for.
struggle.
Miss Claudia Mo, there's a quorum? Okay. Mr. Deputy, the administration chose to announce the consultation exercise on constitution reform today. Is hoping that there will be side effect when this free TV license case will no longer grab any attention, and constitution reform will go first, and also, of course, there's the Thai Long Sai Wan case. But this saga on the free TV license issue case is not just about people getting angry because there's no TV to watch, but rather there are so many issues involved in this saga. Some might say we only had a debate on powers and privileges motion not long ago. How come we're back again? Well, we teachers always tell students you have to persevere. You can't say, oh, because we failed once, that's it. Let's just pack up and go home. No, we must keep trying. And by keep trying doesn't mean that we keep trying the same approach. Is there any new development? Yes, indeed. As you can see, on this TV license issuing case, there's a problem with due process. Something's gone wrong. The spirit of due process has also gone wrong. My powers and privileges motion seeks to summon Ricky Wong and Stephen Ho, the chairman of the Communications Authority. Empress Ho, chairman of the Communications Authority. Last time when Mr. Ricky Wong came to meeting, I asked him from a distance, if you enjoy protection under the powers and privileges ordinance, would you be happy to disclose, to make public the report you have and also the setbacks and the whole process of your application? Would you be willing to disclose that? And he said he's more than happy to do so. And then Mr. Ambrose Ho, chairman of the Communications Authority, has also spoken up. Now, Mr. Ho did not attend the meeting of the panel on information technology and broadcasting, but we wrote us a letter. He distanced himself from the administration. The Communications Authority has always been telling the EXCO that the EXCO should issue all free license, grant all free licenses, but the EXCO wouldn't listen to them. The Communications Authority is a professional body. It is the regulating authorities of the TV industry in Hong Kong. The Communications Authority is answerable to the public. And some reporters asked Mr. Ho, well, Mr. Ho wouldn't come to your panel. Why would you want to summon him under the powers and privileges ordinance? But what would we know? Maybe he how would we be sure that he won't say more if he has the protection of powers and privileges ordinance? And the chairman of the Communications Authority is a public office, so he has an obligation to be answerable to the public. The secretary said that the Communications Authority hasn't spoken up against the administration. True, it hasn't gone that far, but it's certainly distanced itself from the administration. And there's another new development, of course, that's caused quite an uproar in the media. That is, the person in charge of the consultancy firm spoke up, definitely. That's was speaking up against the government. She even said that perhaps the government has fixed a raise. And the administration has misquoted from the consultancy report. Now, there's some oral question this morning by Mr. Frederick Fung, who's still on the free TV license issue. The reply of the secretary is astounding. You wouldn't know whether to cry or laugh. I can see even Mr. Deputy is wearing a smile because it's so outrageous. Mr. Wong Kwok Kin? Sorry, speaker's not coming through. In the chamber, it seems that there aren't enough members. He's calling for a quorum. Are you calling for a quorum? Yes.
八個，頭先有幾個啱走咗啊！啱走咗佢先 call。
Miss Claudia MO. Okay, fine. I'll call him again. Mr. Deputy, let us continue. I was trying very hard to tease Mr. Gregory So. Earlier, when he gave a reply to Mr. Frederick Fong's oral question on the rebuttal by the consultancy against the government. The person in charge of the consultancy firm actually questioned whether the government fixed the rates. These are strong terms, and you can tell that the consultants couldn't put up with this because they have professional reputation as well, and they're quoted by the government to say that it's about picking two out of three, but then the government denied it now. It said that the consultancy report was just one of the factors considered. Now, it's in black and white, paragraph 2 of the reply. You'll be so astounded by this reply. It says that the person in charge of the consultant or paragraph B, it says, we are surprised and perplexed. I don't know who we are, perhaps the senior officials of government. It says that we are surprised and perplexed, and that the consultant disregard its professional ethics. The government finds it very regrettable and is inappropriate for the lady in charge of the consultant. She's just expressed her personal views, but there's no respect for the spirit of the contract, and then the consultant has not maintained its neutrality as a consultant. Well, Hong Kong is a free market. We're a free port. People come here to do business. It's a private company. It's trying to defend its own professional reputation. Now, I think members from the business sector must listen me out here. Here we're talking about business. This is about demand and supply in the commercial market. So the government commissioned the consultancy, and the consultancy came up with a professional report. And then the government quoted from the report, and I thought, well, you quoted from a report wrongly. You obviously wanted me to say something that you want to hear. I don't know how many millions of dollars or tens of millions of dollars that you spend on the consultancy report. And this so-called consultancy report is supposed to echo the wish of the government. Otherwise, it's not right. If any commercial company receives such a treatment from the government, I think anyone in his right mind would come out and say something in defense of themselves. And on this TV market issue, as a member of the Hong Kong community, the person should also say something in fairness. Now, that is all the more a reason why we should take a look at the content of the consultant's report. Now, that's in the oral question. And you, the government, you say we, that means the government. You are taking the authority of the government as a whole, and you're trying to criticize a private company. Do you dare to face this consultancy firm and debate the issue? I don't think you dare to answer that question. The TV market is barely surviving here. If ATV has got good programs, if TVB has got good programs, there will be two new service providers now in cable. So two more choices for Hong Kong. If there are good choices, then Hong Kong people won't react so strongly. You know, we work hard, we work long hours to make a living. Why is it that these people would bother to take to the street? Hundreds of thousands of people taking to the street. It's caused a surprise in the international arena. People outside wonder why Hong Kong people are so angry just because they don't get to watch, they don't have TV programs to watch. Last year, on the front page of the Ming Pao Daily, there was this report. Front page is page A1 because there was advertisement on page A1, so it's A2. The Asia TV program criticized scholarism, and it attracted over 10,000 complaints. That ATV program was called ATV Focus. And during that period, the young people of the scholarism were protesting outside by the central government offices against national educational brainwashing. And then this current affairs program of ATV, the commentators say that these young people know nothing, they're being exploited by politicians. The Communications Authority received a record number of complaints in the history of the TV market in Hong Kong. ATV, well, many members have said a lot already. I remember someone actually teased Jasper Zhang why he would appear at an ATV current affairs program because it's a zero audience rating. Now, we can say this because we are protected by the Powers and Privileges Ordinance. We are free to speak our mind. I hope other members will agree to give Mr. Ricky Wong the opportunity. He's very willing to speak. And also, I want you to give the opportunity to Mr. Ambrose Ho. Maybe he's not so keen, but still he's a public officer. He should be able to speak freely because he has to he would have the protection of powers and privileges ordinance. The problems of ATV, I think we all know them so well, there's no point repeating those problems. The latest ATV story, I learned from reporters, 4 years, for 4 years, the ATV failed to submit audited accounts, is fined $200,000. The reason given was that the ATV was so busy, it did not have time to engage auditors. Well, how come the people in ATV were so busy? Because they had to deal with so many complaints and disputes. I think that's so ridiculous. It's beyond imagination. There's this black box. It's black box operation. This describes the TV industry in Hong Kong. TVB is a prominent TV station. It's not really their fault. But there are just ATV and TVB. And ATV is so feeble. You know, my opponent is so weak. Of course, I become dominant. You can't blame me for being strong. But when there's just one dominant TV station, it leads to problems that we all saw. That's why there's such a public anger. And even the communications authority says that TVB is hoarding artists. And TVB is fine because it acts in anti-competitive manner. We asked Mr. Ho, the chairman of the Communications Authority. Now, say I'm an artist, but there's only TVB is prominent. I want people to be able to see me. I want exposure, so I dare not offend TVB. So I will exercise self-censorship. I will continue to speak Putonghua because I don't want to offend the management of TVB. This is spoken rule. There's no need to spell out in the contract to say that you must speak Putonghua and not Cantonese when you're interviewed on another TV station. No, there's no need to write it out. And even Ambrose Ho said, we won't give up. The dominance of TVB is an issue outside the scope of discussion on the day, but this is a fact in the TV market in Hong Kong. The reason why Hong Kong people are angry is because somehow, Ricky Wong's TV station is left out when the government is to pick two from three. Is it really due to a basket of factors? At least we have to have sight of the consultancy report so we can be sure whether what went wrong with the due process. Thank you.
I now propose the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Honorable Claudia MO be passed. Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development, Mr. Deputy, on the 15th of October, the administration announced that the CE in Council gave approval in principle to approve the applications from the Hong Kong Television Entertainment as well as Fantastic TV Limited and reject the application from the Hong Kong Television Network Limited, and that's in accordance with CAP 562, the Broadcasting Ordinance. Today, it is already the second time within a month's time that the members of the LegCo are invoking Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance to move a motion, and the administration is against today's motion. As on the 6th of November, there is a motion under the PNP of the LegCo. Last time it was moved by Mr. Charles Mok. We didn't agree to this because this would only destroy our systems. It won't help the public to know more about the EXCO's decision. We'll only be wasting the time of both the executive as well as the legislature. It will only further politicize the matter. As the CEO has already said earlier on, we are talking about complicated issue concerning the applications from three organizations. When you come comment on this, you should cite the original words of the administration as well as seeing them in the context instead of quoting from people who quoted from the government or anything which hasn't been officially confirmed. I want to take this opportunity to further explain the relevant decision and clarify the misunderstanding. First of all, there is still misunderstanding in the society that having a gradual and orderly approach in introducing competition in the market is against the market opening policy, or it has changed the so-called rules of the game. I've already said that whether it was the policy of opening up the TV market as promulgated in 1998 or the bill itself, it was never said that as soon as somebody meets the requirement, the basic requirements, and then the application will be granted. All applications must be commented on by the CA first, and then the ISCO will consider all relevant factors and then decide on whether a license would be issued or not. In relation to the sustainability of the free TV market as a whole, the ISCO considered the relevant findings of the consultants as well as the representations of the applicants on the report of the consultants as well as latest position. And then we have been cautious to make sure that there will be sustainable and healthy and stable development of the free TV market. Therefore, we've decided on a gradual and orderly approach in introducing competition into the free TV market. But we do not preclude the possibility of allowing more TV operators as and when appropriate. Secondly, I want to say that somebody has misunderstood that the ISCO has made the relevant decision because it has taken into account the profit and loss of individual organizations. We repeatedly said that whether for the existing free TV stations or the three applicants, the sustainability of individual organizations has not been a decisive factor to be considered. In fact, we focus on the sustainable development of the entire free TV market. Faced with the uncertainties and in the light of the importance of the free TV market, we have been cautious in making the decision. The government has been trying to enhance the strength of Hong Kong as a free economy. We continue to provide favorable business environment for the development of enterprises. We also want to provide the appropriate regulatory regime to make sure that there will be fair and smooth operation of the free market. When it comes to broadcasting policies, we have established a licensing regime, and all along we have been trying to broaden program choices, we encourage innovation, and we want to maintain our competitiveness. With the three applications, the ISCO has adopted a broad view to consider the business environment of the free TV market. We want to make sure that there will be healthy and orderly development. This is always in line with the established principles of the government. Certainly, I want to talk about the fact that the Broadcasting Ordinance clearly distinguishes the different roles and powers of the CA as well as the ISCO in the licensing process. The ISCO has the duty to consider the recommendations of the CA and then act in accordance with the laws to decide on the question of licensing. The law does not say that the ISCO and the CA must align their views before making a decision. The law only says that whether a license is to be granted for free TV, the ISCO has the final say. Now, the approach is a gradual and orderly approach, and it is an established policy, and the ISCO has no need to consult the CA again. In fact, when we considered the view submitted by the CA, the ISCO already noted the CA's view concerning the sustainability of the market as a whole. And in fact, in the process, the ISCO had also invited the CA to comment on the representations of the relevant organizations and have and confirmed whether the representations would affect the views of the CA. In fact, in the electoral brief, the administration already gave an account about the position of the CA. The CA on the 7th of November provided a paper to the IT panel of the electoral and stated the same position. Fourthly, we have always been acting in accordance with the law and the established system in dealing with the three applications. The ISCO has been abiding by procedural justice, and we have also made taken into account local as well as overseas legal advice. And in the process, the Exco has already asked for supplementary information from the relevant organizations in the light of developments and asked them to give representations. And before making a decision, the Exco has already disclosed the four consultants' reports to the applicants and have given them ample time and opportunities for them to make rounds of response and representations. On the question of applications for free TV licenses, of course the public would like to have to more licenses. For the 11 factors considered by the Exco, public opinion has been included. The Exco is the licensing authority when exercising the approval powers given by the law. The Exco must consider and balance all the relevant factors. Mr. President, the decision was made after full consideration in accordance with the relevant laws, policies and procedures. The overall interest of Hong Kong is taken into account and is given priority. If anybody is aggrieved by the decision and would like to go to the court to address the grievance, the administration respects the legal rights. If the LegCo is to invoke the PMP to intervene, then this will destroy the confidentiality system of the Exco. This would only further politicize the matter. If the motion is to be endorsed, what actually has to be made the subject matter of investigation, the motion points out that one of the organization will be ordered to give evidence, so will be the CA, and they have to provide the relevant information. Such information will involve the Exco's papers for their consideration, and this will destroy the established and effective confidentiality system. In fact, the Exco has scrutinized a lot of information. Disclosing the information will only be partial, and then it will cause misunderstanding and misinterpretation. This is unfair to everybody. Please veto today's motion. We also have to focus on the second phase of the applications for licenses so as to introduce competition into the free TV market to benefit the public. Thank you.
Mr. Gary Fan. Mr. Deputy, I want to say that my party supports Ms. Claudia Mo's motion. This is the second time that we, in a LegCo sitting, debate whether we should invoke upon the LegCo Powers and Privileges Ordinance to investigate the vetting process with regard to applications for domestic free TV program service licenses. Now, the administration has not explained to us why it has refused to give approval in principle to HKTV network. The will of one man alone has led to a refusal to grant approval in principle to HKTVN. It has ignored the need to observe procedural justice. The consultant has provided professional, objective and balanced advice. But the decision has been based on or has been based on the Exco's will or the CE's will. Section 10 of the Broadcasting Ordinance states that the CE and Council may make a decision on applications having regard to the advice provided by the CA. So we can see that on licensing matters, the CA plays a very important role. In fact, many former BA members had a lot of expertise in TV broadcasting matters. They were able to give a lot of sound and valuable advice to the CEN Council, and I think their views should have been fully respected. Mr. Ambrose Ho, chairman of the CA, said earlier that in fact the Bureau had all along said that three licenses would be issued, and it was not necessary nor was it appropriate to rank the three applicants. President, So it seems that the administration and the CA have told us very different stories. We can see that when the CEE in Council made its decision, it did not take into account the advice and the recommendations of the former BA. The CA is the most important advisory body to the administration on broadcasting matters, and yet its recommendations have been rejected by the CE in Council altogether. So they said that the former BA members were not able to give sound and practical advice, or was it that the CE in Council has never viewed the applications from a broadcasting perspective? Or else, how come the CE in Council has turned a deaf ear to the advice of the former BA? We can see that there were major policy changes. Initially, there was no cap on the number of licenses to be issued. But subsequently, only 2 out of 3 were chosen. The applicants were invited to give representations, but then before that, the CA had not been consulted, and the CA had not been asked to provide fresh or supplementary advice after the change in policy. So in other words, after the policy has changed, the CA has not been asked to give supplementary or new advice. This is contrary to Section 10 of the Broadcasting Ordinance. So LegCo needs to invoke upon the Powers and Privileges Ordinance to require the former BA or the CA to disclose all the relevant documents so that we can ascertain whether the administration has breached Section 10 of the Broadcasting Ordinance. Now, the RTHK-TV section has decided to produce a new series of Under the Lion Rock, and the TV series will feature young people's struggle for survival, how they work hard to pursue their dreams. So I want to know whether we still have this spirit, this spirit of Under the Lion Rock. In other words, are we still courageous enough to find out the truth? We have our duties to perform. We should protect and uphold this Hong Kong spirit, so that Hong Kong will still have a fair business environment. We need to prove to the world that in Hong Kong we still have the rule of law. Thank you.
Mr. Sin Chung Kai, I speak to support Ms. Claudia Mo's motion to invoke the LCPMP ordinance to call Mr. Ricky Wong and Mr. Ambrose Ho. What the chairman of the CA, well, when it comes to the chairman of the CA, they sent a letter to the LegCo saying that they once made the recommendations of issuing 3 licenses. Relevant information has been disclosed before. Well, why do we need to summons Mr. Ricky Wong? I believe that Mr. Ricky Wong will have a lot to say. Well, during a recent wedding banquet of an elite I attended, I came across Ricky Wong and I gave him encouraging words that he should not give up, and he said he's still holding up. He told me something that I found unbelievable. Or perhaps I just don't believe what he says. I've always thought that CY Leung did not issue a license to Ricky Wong's company because of an order given by Beijing. But Ricky Wong said to me that day that on the day, that is after the announcement of two successful applications was made, the liaison office and Beijing called him to ask him why he was not included. It's really puzzling that the liaison office and Beijing called to ask him why he did not get a license. They seem very concerned. It seems that we've wronged CY Leung because we thought that CY Leung received orders. Perhaps, he had cheated Beijing and the liaison office. But, well, those were the words said to me by Ricky Wong. Perhaps it would be better for us to summons him, so that he can tell us whether it was CY Leung or Beijing that refused him the license. Perhaps let me say a few words more. After the LegCo election last year, Ricky Wong approached me and Charles and lobbied us. He was only lobbying us for one thing only. Well, out of the many discussions we had on license issuance, he's never lobbied us to ask me to support him in the license application. He said that it's been over 1,000 days and still there were no licenses issued. And the whole thing was moving at a snail's pace. And it was only a license. So last year, after a meeting, we urged the administration to issue licenses. Not to Ricky Wong, just to issue licenses. Ricky Wong, on many different occasions, showed confidence that the BA would issue three licenses. But at that time, I said, perhaps it's 2 out of 3. And if that is the case, you would definitely lose. But he was very confident, perhaps it's because he's read the reports. And towards the middle and the end, I said, if there are only 2, you would definitely lose. And he said he's read all the reports. In none of the reports was he ranked last. He may not be the first, but he's definitely not the last. If what Mr. Wong said is true, then the decision made by the Exco is contrary to the recommendation of the CA. The chief executive will come to the question and answer session, and I will ask why is not the last one that got kicked out. If one is not to be promoted to the next grade up, definitely is the one that ranked last in class. You talk about a basket of factors. What are those factors? The secretary kept saying that we should not politicize this thing. If you refer to the broadcasting ordinance, the design is that the CEO and council will make a final decision because the broadcasting authority is a technical organization. It will make recommendations for the consideration of the CE in Council. What other factors will CE in Council consider? Political ones, of course. And when it comes to political ones, the most important thing is that from Beijing. So, well, the secretary is right. It's not a basket of factors. It's all down to one man. Well, technocrats recommended 3 licenses. Consultants. Well, the consultant now openly opposed to the administration. And he said, Well, we asked for the report and then we asked them for further information. But the administration did not say whether they have approached other consultants. If not, is it the case that the IXCO is an expert? I understand that none of its members come from broadcasting, let alone television. Well, when it comes to we need to summon people to get to the bottom of the truth, and we need to actually summon CY Leung to get a glimpse of it. Well, three bureau secretaries support three licenses, and in the end, one man decided to issue only two reports. Why did this particular man want to issue two licenses? Well, we can imagine that ever since he's taken office of the chief executive, his position has been precarious. At first, people thought that he was very good, but then he called into his government a ragtag group, and things only get bad to worse. And there is only one conclusion: when governance is getting poorer and poorer, when Hong Kong's fabric is being torn up, and he won't be able to plant himself safely on the seat. So he decided to issue two licenses out of three. So, I believe that today's motion will be defeated. We don't want to give up hope. The chairman of the CA, Ambrose Ho, said in a meeting of the ITBP that we should not lose all hope. And he said that he doesn't care much about being the chairman of the CA. Well, in the past, it's been rare for some cabinet members opposed to a decision made by the administration. And there are government sources saying that the decision is nothing to do with them, they distance themselves. Of course, there are one or two EXCO members who support CY Leung's decision. And today, I hope that the motion will be supported so that Ricky Wong will have a chance to explain and to put forward his case, and actually not to explain. Well, to explain why is the second one that's got kicked out, not the last one. And what was said is very different from what the government said. If we can hear from the horse's mouth, I believe that we can prove that what the administration has said is a deviation from the truth.
Thank you, Ms. Tonight's motion is likened to a electrical luncheon or dinner, and that we eat every other Wednesday. And the Honorable Mo Wan Ting's words sounds very appetizing, but if you eat more than your fair share, you get indigestions. But unfortunately, the secretary's response is likened to a gaoye yao jia guai being remicrowaved, and remicrowaved, which is dry and untasty and unedible. The turmoil caused by the issue of free television program services licenses has continued for nearly 2 months now. Public dissent against the government's decisions has reached a level rarely seen over the last few years. But, Mr. President, nowadays, the present administration, everything is extraordinary, funny, and different. We never understand that. I believe that the SAR government was not only careless, but inept in handling of this issue. The government defense appears to be contrary to the Hong Kong core values of free market principles and ignores the feelings of the people of Hong Kong. The decision simply goes against public aspirations, which was inspired by the openness of the then CY during his election campaign. He brought us to a very high level of expectation. And now, when we cannot see that it's coming in our way, that's a lot of reaction to that. Indeed, the public hasn't accepted ICSCO decision. I still believe that we should not exercise the powers conferred by Electrical Council Powers and Privilege Ordinance to interfere into the ICSCO decision unless it makes a claustrophobic pronouncement. It should adhere to and uphold the traditions of the executive-led government. Unfortunately, again, the present administration is neither traditional in its approach nor outstanding in its action, which have caused all this confusion. And repeatedly, we're seeing this very often in our debates in Legco. An intervention by Legco, I see, would only jeopardize the relationship between the executive and the legislature. It would not bring about a practical resolution. Needless to say, such an intervention would only set a precedent that could have catastrophic consequences. As we all know, disputes over land development, environmental protection, as we have just debated earlier, and reclamation could trigger further confrontations between ICSCO and LegCo if ICSCO's decisions do not meet the aspiration of Hong Kong citizens. Every single simple administrative measures during the past year that the government put forward in LegCo has become an issue of governance. This is not healthy. It has been reported that Mr. Ricky Wong might apply for a judicial review of ICSCO's decision on free television licenses within the next 3 months. Passing today's motion and authorizing the select committee to exercise the power conferred on it by Section 9(1) of Legco PNP Ordinance would only infuse the situation with conspiracy and confrontation, since there is already widespread speculation about the reasons behind the decision. Most importantly, in the eyes of the public, the credibility of the courts of Hong Kong is far higher than that of this council. Therefore, I truly believe that a judicial review probably is a just and convincing means of handling this issue. Mr. President, sad and sorry are the only words I can say on the issue of free TV licensing. First of all, territory-wide mistrust and feeling of anguish have once again been triggered, demonstrating the chief executive's and the ICSCO's serious lack of understanding of public aspirations. The difference between them is not just a narrow gap. They are poles apart. The government's decision was arbitrary, and its subsequent explanation was unconvincingly childish. Even a veteran pro-establishment lawmaker like myself, I cannot understand the reason of their explanation. Frankly, this is the very first time during the last few years that a single decision by the Executive Council has triggered such a society-wide upheaval. And probably this is the beginning of a new era that we will be seeing more of this to come. The former Chief Justice, Mr. Andrew Lee, has said that courts were not the proper channel to resolve complicated political, economic, and social problems. He said that he found it ironic that members of IXCO, as well as those from LegCo, have urged a judicial review to deal with TV license issue. Mr. Andrew Lee's wisdom has never been challenged, probably except in MPC level, at MPC level, when he made his judgment on the case of Garlai. Andrew Lee is a wise man, and we should listen to him. Sending so many political, economic, and social disputes to court only proved the weaknesses of our local governance, the incompetence of the SAR administration. To uphold the governing architecture and safeguard the constitution of the Executive Council, it is a pity that the SAR government has to resort to a judicial review to settle this dispute, which could easily be handled otherwise. Last but not the least, Mr. President, I greatly regret that I saw no sign of much-needed political sensitivity and awareness from the administration in handling this issue. Shouldn't we all learn by experience? If the administration and its governing team really rule in such a reckless and disdainful manner, I believe that those responsible for the ultimate fall of Hong Kong will not be those opposed to China, who are being loyal to Hong Kong and love the country, who have stirred up trouble in Hong Kong. My criticism today comes from the depth of my heart, and I hope that Hong Kong could have a steady, stable government following along the principles of stability and prosperity for Hong Kong. My opposition in today's motion is not aimed at defending the administration, but at protecting our constitution and the governing structure which bestowed upon us by the Basic Law. An investigation conducted under the powers of LegCo PNP Ordinance will not give us the truth. Probably you can only find that in the audit PAC. I'm just put jokes aside. But political conflict, suspicion, and confrontation is very difficult to find a truth. The truth lies within ourselves. And only the government and the Hong Kong people, for the interests of Hong Kong, that we can find a solution. What is the truth? Let it lie inside there. And the government at least listen to the people of Hong Kong to find a solution. As a Hong Kong citizen who yearns for prosperity and stability, I sincerely hope that the chief executive and his SAR government will learn from this issue. Hong Kong should not be ruled by individuals, but by rule of the law. This is the only way to win back support and confidence from the public and the investors, be they local or foreign, in Hong Kong. Thank you, Mr. President.
Liu Yuchong.
Mr. Liu Yuchong. Mr. President, I thank Ms. Claudia Mo for raising this issue again in this council for discussion. I really appreciate what Ms. Claudia Mo is doing. Many people thought that the matter would die down, and people are asking why you are bringing up this matter again for a debate. I want to say that I support Ms. Claudia Mo for what she has done. I also support the HKTVN staff. These staff members haven't given up. They are still holding out till the end. They want to find out the truth of the matter. Now, on the turn off your TV evening, we watched a NHK TVN program together, and the staff told me that they, of course, wanted a license for the company, and they also, more importantly, wanted justice to be done. This incident represents a blatant trampling on the principle of justice. In Hong Kong, we have a weird political system, and time and again, justice has been blatantly trampled upon. These HKTVN staff are continuing their fight, not only because they want the company to get a license, but more importantly because they want to see justice done. So I support Ms. Claudia MO's motion. And for this is a simple issue. This is a livelihood issue. Members of the public want to enjoy better TV programs. But such a modest demand cannot be met. And they really can't help asking why, how come. And the SAR government has not provided these ordinary members of the public with an answer. Ricky Wong and his staff have been trying so hard to try to get a license. The other two companies didn't try as hard. And they were given approved the licenses, but then Ricky Wong and his staff didn't get the license. And the SAR government has not given the public a convincing answer or reply. So we want to know the truth. We really want to get to the bottom of the matter. Oh, in fact, Ms. Claudia MO's motion doesn't affect the CE or the secretary. She merely wants Ricky Wong and Empress Ho to come to Legico to provide some documents. So she is not seeking to summon people from the administration to appear before the council. Ms. Claudia MO wants Ricky Wong and Ambrose Ho to give evidence to the council because she wants to know whether the principles of free market and fair competition have been upheld. So we want to know the truth. We want to find out the truth. We have been denied the truth. I don't think the public can accept the reply and the reasons given by the administration so far. And that is why I support Ms. Claudia MO's motion. Now, the secretary is telling us that there is no need investigating. Carry out an investigation will waste the time of the executive and the time of the legislature, President. In fact, very often, you can say that the time of the legislature is wasted, the time of the executive is wasted. Now, from your point of view, you think time is wasted, or time will be wasted, because you do not want people to probe into your behavior. But to the community, time to investigate, spend on investigating the matter will not be considered wasted. This is because we want to make sure that justice has been done. So if you think spending time to seek justice is a waste of time, then that shows your attitude. You're not concerned about whether justice is done or not. NEGCO wants to have access to the relevant records, documents. You said that that would jeopardize the EXCO's confidentiality system. But then you said that if the matter went to court, you would give the necessary cooperation and support. So what do you mean? Is it that you will be providing all the relevant records and papers to the courts? Then that would also mean jeopardizing the EXCO's confidentiality system. So I really don't understand. Why is it that disclosing the information to LegCo will breach the confidentiality system, while disclosing the documents in the courts or to the courts will not constitute a breach of the confidentiality system? So I want to say that these justifications are extremely weak. And I don't understand why you have put forward these as justifications. As Mr. Sin has pointed out, it was said that the liaison office and the CPG asked why Ricky Wong could have failed in his application. So you can see that there's a lot of speculation in society, and such speculation will cause unrest. So why is it that the administration is not concerned about having caused unrest in society? So if this motion is passed, if we can invite the two gentlemen to come before the council, then we will be able to know the truth. Everybody will be able to know the truth. Why is it that it's better to conceal the truth? Why is it better to be like an ostrich? Now, we carry our investigations because we want the truth to be revealed. This is the correct approach. This is the correct attitude. But how come our administration prefers to be vague? Why? How come it prefers to hide the truth from the public? Now, as we haven't got the truth yet, the matter has not been concluded. And this matter is like a time bomb in society. Many HKTVN staff told me that they would take to the streets on New Year Day. I believe there will be more protests, more marches, until the truth is revealed and justice has been done. I don't think Hong Kong people will give up so easily. So I want to urge my colleagues to support Ms. Claudia Mo's motion. We want to know the truth as soon as possible. We want to see justice done. Thank you. I support the motion.
主席，4个礼拜前，立法会在这里经过12个小时的辩论， 否决了莫乃光议员提出引用《特权、权力及特权条例》向政府索取免费电视牌照资料的原议案，以及郭荣亨议员提出的修正案。四个。Free
TV license issuance was defeated. Now, 4 weeks later, we are in the same place debating on a similar motion. Similar in nature, but different in wordings. and this is the fourth one this term. It's the same issue, and it's been brought up again and again. The issue is about whether or not to issue license. President, I understand that the license issuance aroused public concern, but the LCPMP ordinance is a trump card. Should we use this on this license incident? Should we use it so easily? Use it as a threat on the administration? Hong Kong is a business society. The issuance of license does not only involve Hong Kong TV. It also involves other two prospective operators. They supplied a large amount of commercial information under the applications. We can imagine that the information may include financial information, manpower arrangements, investment plans, and business plans. We need confidentiality. Without confidentiality, what business organization will supply sensitive information in an application? If information supplied under confidentiality is reviewed because of public pressure, how can people trust Hong Kong anymore? Overseas investors will not dare to come to Hong Kong to invest. The parent companies of the successful applicants are listed companies in Hong Kong, and there is commercial secrets involved. If in the course of the process the sensitive or commercial secrets are divulged, it may affect the securities market and it may cause loss, financial loss. And then who is to be held responsible? So because of this principle, we should not disclose the information. Ms. Mo's motion's wording is to summon Mr. Ricky Wong and the relevant personnel of the Communications Authority. But if we are to investigate to the bottom of a matter, you will need more than one or two people. You should not rely on only one side of the story for them to supply you information and for you to believe that you have the comprehensive picture. If during the production of the information, commercially sensitive information, and commercial secrets are divulged, it will undermine the confidentiality system. And that is something I do not agree. I've heard a lot of voices in relation to this incident. A lot of people would like the administration to improve on the way they handle the license issuance. The relevant officials have explained the criteria and details of the license issuance. When it comes to protecting the EXCO structure, the system, the confidentiality, the administration has already given us as much explanation as possible. The LCPMP ordinance is very powerful. We may summon anyone and require the production of any information and document. If it's well used, of course, it will help the role of the legislature in monitoring the executive. But if it's used too often, it's abused, then the consequences are dire. It's been 16 years since reunification. On a number of occasions, the LegCo invoked the PNP ordinance to investigate into significant issues. but it's only been 14 months since this legislative session. And we have on a number of occasions debated on whether to use the PMP ordinance on the license issuance four times. If we keep breaking up motions that was once defeated, change a few words here and there, and move the motion again, then it's actually the same thing and it will be meaningless. And there are a lot of issues, say for example housing, aging population, education, and the overall economic development of Hong Kong, are important enough for us to have discussions. We should focus our attention on these issues instead of repeating on motions that have been broken down from similar motions. A lot of people told me that the Legislative Council may not be the best platform to resolve this issue. If we use the PMP ordinance to interfere, not only will it undermine the confidentiality system of the EXCO, it will also politicize the entire matter, and it will not help at all. I understand that society requires the government to be more transparent, but once we've invoked the PMP ordinance, we have to pay hefty prices. I so submit.
Mr. Li Chiu-Yan, well, the Labour Party, of course, supports Ms. Claudia Mo's motion to invoke PMP. Well, it's a case of someone having been wronged. It's just like a coroner's court. We want to find out the true cause of death. But there are members saying that we have so many issues to deal with. But we are concerned about whether it's just to issue just 2 free television licenses. Is it not important for people to have more choice of TV service? But when we talk about one important issue, you say that we should pay attention to other issues. But when we want to talk about housing production targets, you are not concerned. You're only concerned about the stamp duties. And when we talk about free TV licenses, you say we should pay attention to other things, as if we are wasting time. But this is important. First, it's about people's choice to free TV. For years, people have been suffering. They have lost their patience. There's only just one dominant TV station. It's a blow to creativity. For those who are aspiring to join the trade, and artists have been fooled around by TVB. If we have one more TV station, at least there's one additional choice. And you don't seem to care. And you keep saying that we need to develop our creative industries. Why not support this TV license? So it's just strange. We shouldn't just let this go so lightly, because it's totally unjust. 4 weeks ago, there was a debate. And you may say, why do we have to debate it again? Of course, if we won 4 weeks ago, there would be no need to do it now. We'll be on to an investigation. 4 weeks ago, that you said you should not undermine the confidentiality of the EXCO. And now we say, okay, we agree. And you still say no. But there is new information compared with 4 weeks ago. I remember it was the 6th of November. We had a meeting. And then there was a panel meeting. The communications authority came, or they provided us with a paper. And then the consultancy spoke out. And then we know that this is all the more unjust. The CA said one thing which is important, and that is from the very beginning to the very end, They wanted to issue three licenses. So why choose two out of three applications? We asked Mr. Greg So a lot of times and still we got no answer. The CA, in the well, actually, the government resorted to all political tricks to try to get the CA agree to issue two licenses out of three applications. The CA didn't agree, and the government could not get the CA on board. So the CA did not agree, and then the administration, the C in council, went it alone. Because according to the ordinance, whatever decision you want to make, which is against the CA, you should consult the CA. Did you respect the CA? What's the point of appointing the CA if you wanted them to be a rubber stamp? So I have to give some praise to the CA. At least it didn't act like a rubber stamp. Of course, you can say that according to the law, you have to agree after consultation. But what is the spirit of having the CA? So we have a piece of new information compared with last time. So at least we know something new from the CA. And then the consultancy firm also told us something. And that is from the very beginning, when they wrote the report, they thought there should be three licenses issued. They are in favor of issuing three licenses. And when the government wanted to veto Mr. Ricky Wong's application, and then you took things out of the consultancy's report, out of context. And they were talking about another thing, and then you just said that it was a grading exercise, and Mr. Ricky Wong failed. The consultancy firm said that it was never tasked to decide which one of the applicants was unqualified. It was never the task of the consultancy study. So in their mind, the consultancy firm wrote the report on the basis of issuing three licenses. And the report talked about another matter and not about which applicant should be disqualified or refuse a license. Now, with the two pieces of new information, and still members don't want to invoke our powers and privileges. I don't know what kind of justifications do these members have. Mr. Jeffrey Lam is suffering from some sort of illusion. He's saying that if we investigate into this, we may undermine the stock market and the stock market may collapse. Well, you have a very horrible imagination, and you have the audacity to quote this as a justification. Don't insult ourselves. Don't insult electrical members. Well, we know what should be divulged or not, because in the past we knew something should not be divulged. But President, you know that we are talking about consultancy reports, nothing of secret. The sensitive information have all been taken out. And you are talking about as if we are going to leak some important secret, and then terrible things will happen after that. Well, you're running out of excuses. Now you talk about a possible collapse of the financial system, and you claim to represent the business sector. I don't know whether the business sector will feel ashamed by what you have said. it seems that the business sector is not very concerned about fairness or fair competition. Are businessmen interested in maintaining fair competition? Mr. Ricky Wong is a businessman. He buy a piece of land, he hire hundreds of people. It was a big investment, and you are not trying to protect the investor. Instead, you want to protect the two incumbent TV stations, and you can't even represent the business sector in terms of fair competition. Is it because Mr. Ricky Wong is not a member of your Chamber of Commerce, and you only defend the interests of your members? And I don't know, maybe Mr. Ricky Wong is a member of your Chamber of Commerce. And if the business sector is not doesn't care about fair competition, well, you know that I'm not a fan of a free market. But this time, this is about fair competition and free market, and still you don't support it. I don't know what you actually support. And I don't know how the loyalists can invoke to object to the motion. We are not asking for secrets and confidential matters from EXCO. We're just asking for information from Mr. Ricky Wong and some reports. And we want to give Mr. Ricky Wong the protection of powers and privileges that we have. I think we owe not just Mr. Ricky Wong, but in a wider sense, we owe our core values, justice. Actually, it boils down to the issue of one man. And Mr. Sin Chung Kai has broken a secret. It seems that Beijing and the liaison office were not aware of this. So Mr. Ricky Wong fell because of one particular man. So, but the question is why? Or maybe I should use the same term used by Wen Weibao when they criticized me, and that was that there was an ulterior motive. Well, his popularity is not going to improve. So perhaps he wanted our society to sink into chaos. People will lose confidence in the government, no confidence in constitutional reform, and then he wants the constitutional reform to fall through. Maybe that's the intention. You can't blame people for adopting such a conspiracy perspective, because no one can imagine that the government would have done such a thing. So I fully support the motion to invoke our powers and privileges.
Mr. James Tian. President. So this motion is about the recent TV, free-to-air TV license issuing. Now, in fact, we have been viewing programs of TVB and ATV, and decades ago, there was a variety of programs aired by the two TV stations, but of course now we have cable TV, we have Now, and those who can afford it can subscribe to pay TV service and get more choices. But for those who can't afford it, they only have two Cantonese free-to-air television stations. And so I think it's understandable why the public want more TV stations. They want more TV licenses to be issued so that they can get more choice. So in 07, 08, 09, we were told that the government intended to issue more licenses. Now, you know, Mr. Ricky Wong has made big investments.
there's this site in Chung Kwan O, and in fact, it was quite obvious that the government wanted him to operate a free-to-air TV service. But now, Ricky Wong's application has been rejected. The other two are successful. And so Ricky Wong wants to know whether the scores he gets are the lowest. But no one knows. There were two meetings held by the ITBP. There are no Liberal Party members on the panel, but I attended the two meetings. I listened very attentively. One meeting was held on the 21st, and I could see that the executive didn't handle the matter well. Now, Mr. Lam Wun Kong is the convener of EXCO. EXCO gives advice and the CE makes the decision. So we were told that the EXCO made the decision. But in fact, the matter was dealt with by Mr. So's bureau, and then the BA was asked to give advice, and the BA, of course, commissioned consultants to provide recommendations. And as we all know, the consultants' recommendations are affected by the government's inclination. Say, if the government hires a consultant to study whether there is a need for the third runway, now, of course, the consultant knows very well that the government wants to have the third runway. So, at the time, when a consultant received a brief, the understanding should be that no new TV licenses had been issued for decades, and concerning advertising revenue, was it only $3 billion as at 07/08/09, or $3.8 billion for 2011-2012? Now, if there are more stations, then the advertising revenue will go up, and as a result, we'll be able to support more TV stations. And HKTVN was not the applicant which got the lowest score. And then Mr. Ambrose Ho, the chairman of the CA, didn't dare to come to the panel to discuss the issue with LegCo members, but then he attended the ITB panel meeting to discuss the TVB issue and the ATV issue. And I understand that, in fact, Mr. Greg So has suffered from a plunge in his popularity rating because of this matter. The PAN Democrats want an investigation. Now, the Liberal Party is of the view that if you want to invoke upon a powers and privileges ordinance, your intention is to find some information to prove that the administration has not been handling the matter properly. But then concerning the consultants' remarks, the CA chairman's response, and also Mr. So's lame explanation. Now, I think the public have come to their judgment. You can see that their SAR government's rating has plunged, and so has Mr. Greg So's rating. So, in fact, the public all agree that the administration hasn't handled the matter properly. So, even if you carry out an investigation, we may come to the same conclusion, and still, EXCO will not give Ricky Wong a license. Now, if the objective is to make the administration give a license to Mr. Ricky Wong, then in fact there is no need for investigation. So you want to investigate not because you want Ricky Wong to get a license. As many pro-establishment members have pointed out, you want an investigation because you want to embarrass the administration even further, but in fact it's already embarrassed enough. You know, they are unable to give convincing reasons. Now, in the House Committee, I spoke for 2 minutes, President, and I said at the House Committee that the PAN Democrats were not toothless tigers. They also had a very powerful weapon, but their powerful weapon was not the Powers and Privileges Ordinance. You know, look at politics in overseas countries. Now, when seeing it in Hong Kong, the PAN Democrats keep talking about the fact that they are seeking genuine universal suffrage. And so can I ask you what your genuine intention is to make the administration give the license to Ricky Wong? Now, I think you have your powerful weapon, political compromise, political bargains. In fact, I said that day that the Obama Care and Patient Act, though the Republican Party did not support Obamacare, but ultimately voted in support because of a political deal. Now, you know, to the top three priorities of the government are housing, medical and health. And so, you know, the administration doesn't want property prices to continue to rise. They want to curb property prices pending the increase in supply. And so there are these so-called harsh measures, demand-side measures. Now, so perhaps you can bargain with the administration in this manner. If you do not give Ricky Wong a license, then we will vote against the harsh measures, the demand-side measures. And you know, many in the pro-establishment camp do not support the harsh measures, and the government will know that the bill will not be passed. Concerning the third license, maybe EXCO will have to find an excuse. Say, for example, EXCO can invite Ricky Wong to apply again and then find some explanations to give Ricky Wong a license. Now, you want an investigation, but even after the investigation, EXCO may still not give Ricky Wong a license. Now, the barristers know judicial review processes. Even if there is a judicial review, it doesn't mean that Ricky Wong will get the license. So we investigate and investigate. We prove that the administration is very wrong. In fact, the public already know that they are very wrong. But how can you give Ricky Wong his license? By political compromise. I understand that in overseas countries, political deals are very common. So if you want Hong Kong people to have an additional choice, if you want to give the license back to Ricky Wong, I think political compromise is more effective. Now, in fact, it is not that we endorse the administration's approach to this matter. And then concerning commercial secrets, after also after tendering, you chose 2 out of 3, and you were not able to explain why the loser was not the one with the lowest score. I want to tell you that that really tarnishes the reputation of Hong Kong as a business center. The business sector is worried. Ms. Mo's motion is about the CA and Ricky Wong's company. It doesn't mention anything about EXCO. Now, the issue of confidentiality of the EXCO system was in Mr. Charles Smock's motion. The motion was defeated. Now, Liberal Party on this occasion will abstain from voting. I understand that in the House Committee, if we abstain from voting, then we are really abstaining from voting. But in a legislative sitting, abstaining has a different meaning. So, make use of other powerful weapons to arrive at political compromises or negotiations with the government. There are things that the administration needs your assistance on. Now, in the afternoon, we had one example. You know, the administration was very concerned about the Talong Sai Wan issue. With your support, the administration was worry-free. In fact, opposition parties around the world do strike political deals with the ruling parties. You may not agree with me. So there are always gives and takes. In fact, you are fully capable of getting what you want. Although you don't really have the majority votes, you can bargain with the administration, and as a result, you can achieve what you want to achieve. And so the Liberal Party will abstain from voting on this motion.
Okay.
Mr. Ray Chan, before I speak, I'd like to reply to what Mr. Tian said. I listened intently. Mr. Tian said that the council is different from House Committee meeting. If you vote against it, if you abstain in a council sitting, you may as well leave. Because in effect, if you're abstaining, then you're practically casting a vote against. So why don't you just leave? Whether we support CY Leung's stamp duty harsh measures or the destination order, he will still go ahead. There are precedents. The OALA OH living allowance. Mr. Tian, you would like to relax the ceiling of the means test. DAB said a certain amount, we said $1 million. And CY Leung would rather nothing happen than conceding to our request. On the 15th of October, the government only granted a license approval to Fantastic TV and Hong Kong TV Entertainment, but reject the application of Hong Kong TV. He said that a gradual and orderly manner in the introduction of a competition is to be adopted because he's afraid that the market cannot sustain all applicants. And so far, the administration still refused to release the scoring criteria on the license application. Well, so far there are no answers about the consultant's views and why 2 are picked out of 3. Well, there is always a reason. There's always a reason why the popularity rating of the administration plummeted, because the mainstream view is very clear. People say, well, Ms. Mo, aren't you bored? Well, we're not here to come up with new ideas. If you come up with a new argument, if you give us something, some new argument, some new evidence, yes. But we still don't get any answers from an old question. C.Y. Leung and Greg So has never answered or could not answer our question. And Mr. Tian said, well, you see that he acts like a ruffian. So you either have, so you may have to just leave it at that. If we just leave it at that, then it will be very easy, because they only have to drag on for 2 months for the heat to die down, and then that's it. It will be left at that. Because when an issue comes up, those who object will come out, those who support will come out, and then there will be mainstream view, and then that, and then afterwards, that's it. If you don't want to just leave it at that, what else can you do? Pursue. To pursue it, keep pursuing it. To explore every avenue to pursue it. Apart from PNP, we need something more. We need something that is more aggressive. We can't just get fob off. Well, we will still be standing even if you play the same record. You act like a human gramophone. 3 months later, we will still move a motion of PNP because we want to get some answers. And when it comes to the program, when it comes to choices of television stations, well, I think Hong Kong HKTV has the capacity to challenge the TV hegemony, but Hong Kong TV was excluded. In an indirect way, they have sustained the domineering position of only one station, because they will just stop some actors and actresses from appearing, and they will suppress freedom of speech, and now they want to just take potential competitors out of the market. No matter who you ask, no expert or academics will support such an approach, which completely violates fair competition. Well, let's look at ATV. They may have a viewership of 1%, and they may be rerunning numerous programs. Well, you have to separate rerun from a playback. Well, whether it is a rerun or a playback, they are just wasting the precious resources of public airwave. Greg So, Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development, is to be held responsible. I've asked many questions. The Secretary either dodged it or gave me the same answer and said, well, your question has been answered. CY Leung's popularity rating reached minus 31 as a result of the HKTV license rejection. Well, that is the result of them dragging their feet. They reject Tell Hong Kong TV from entering the market without giving justification. Ricky Wong sold off his son, the Hong Kong, the City Telecom, and he started recruiting and produced hundreds of over 100 hours of television program. He was only doing it for the public, for the market. He was a practitioner with a heart, and his dream has been scuppered. And the administration still saying that they support free market. But from this single incident, it shows us what it's all about. What they do runs counter to support of innovation and creativity. Well, housewives who like to stay at home, take out, they take to the streets. So you cannot risk the wrath of housewives, but you can risk the wrath of CY Leung. As long as there is no license, we will be dunning you. And you said, well, it's nothing to do with you because you said that is down to the CEN Council. So whether it's successful or not, it's nothing to do with you. But now, because you wanted to defend CY Leung, you act against public view. Of course, you're paid to do that. But you failed to explain what is gradual and orderly manner in the introduction of competition. And based on what do you decide the future of a potential television station? And it says that they want to avoid cutthroat competition. They want to enable the healthy, sustainable development of the market. But we asked for detail. How? You did not give us any answer. Next time there will be the same motion. Well, we have competitions trying to poach actors, trying to come up with the best program. Which of it is adverse? Which of it will cause the audience to not watch television, and which of them will cause the quality of programs to drop? Well, TVB will always be there, no matter there is one or two or three players. Well, the one who's going to go out will be ATV. What loss is it to the public? But with one domineering television station, there will be inertia. They churn out CD lowbrow programs, and in the end, the audience suffer. Well, additional license will break the situation. Through competition, low quality TV stations will be phased out, and it deserves it. There may be a television station folding as a result. Well, if we're talking about ATV, the new players, they have made their calculations. They will take responsibility and the risk of the investment. They won't turn around and blame the administration for issuing a license. Well, if they're given a license, if they fear failure, then they will not operate. So the overall impact of the market, what specifically? ATV? You said no. You said it's not profitability or loss of a TV station. Then is it a TVB? Well, with additional license, maybe the business environment may be a little bit more difficult than the TVB. We've been asking for reasons for picking 2 out of 3. The administration said that according to the consultant, well, the market will sustain 3 operators if in favorable conditions, 4, but it's difficult for the market to sustain 5 players. And that as a result, they need to introduce a competition in a gradual and orderly manner. That's why they picked 2 out of 3. In a special meeting of the ITB panel, I asked the secretary, whom did not answer me. If it's a gradual and orderly manner, it should be 1 out of 3, not 2 out of 3. You should add 1 at a time. Well, how would you know that ATV will fold or not if you give more than 1 license? You'll be blamed because instead of 1 additional license, you issue 2, and you have destroyed the market environment and ATV folds. Of course, the closure of ATV is nothing to do with you. We all know that. M. Bruce Ho, chairman of the CA, submitted a document on the 8th of November to the LegCo. They say that the administration has not asked the authority to consider the gradual and orderly approach. And their recommendation is to issue 3 applications free licenses because it would serve the it would be the best in public interest. And the secretary said that, well, the consultant report is only one of the 11 factors, and then this EXCO will also take into account the latest market development and other factors. What is it? How do you gauge the latest market situation? Not from reading the report, but from reading newspapers, and then you draw your own conclusion what as to what the latest market condition is, and decide that you need to pick two out of three. We know that this is not a basket of factors, but is one man, C.Y. Leung, who called the shots in the end, in order to clarify and dispel concerns, they need to give us a full explanation. Well, if it is in the end the CE is the only one against the issuance of that license, whereas the all 11 factors are favorable, then there is a reason for them not to disclose any information. I support Ms. Mo's motion because by disclosing more information, we know who's in the right and who is in the wrong. And this motion is milder than previous motions, Dennis Kwok's and Charles Mok's. But still, if you can get one person to testify, one more document, it will be better. But the administration is afraid that there may be some unfavorable information leaked out or disclosed. And as a result, legislators who object to the PMP motion will have to change their vote. I support the motion.
Mr. Raymond Wong, thank you, President. On the 6th of November, this council vetoed the... Sorry. Ms. Alice Mack, any question? Well, let's count the quorum. Mr. Raymond Wong, President, on the 6th of November, this Council vetoed the motion to invoke power and privileges in asking the government to produce all documents relating to the Hong Kong free Hong Kong TV and the free TV licenses incident. Mr. Ricky Wong has said he would consider launching a judicial review. On the 8th of November, the Communications Authority issued a paper saying that their recommendation was to issue three licenses, and the consultancy firm responsible for the consultancy study adopted a high profile in criticizing the government as taking things out of context from their reports. And also the next media has been boycotted by the TVB because of the bad coverage offered. And Mr. Ricky Wong, in response to a rumor that he was involved in a sex scandal, saying that he was smeared. I think the focus is now very blurred. The public attention has now been shifted from the free TV license to TVB and then to Ricky Wong. I think all these will become unfocused, more and more unfocused. And now this motion is about asking Mr. Ricky Wong and Mr. Ambrose Ho, Chairman of the CA, to come to this a council to testify or send representative to do so. But both of these people cannot really talk about the stance adopted by the C in council and a select committee set up for this purpose. Cannot really look into the reasons why the C in council changed the rules in the middle of the course of the event. And then it would not be able to find out the reason for not issuing the three licenses. So even if this motion is passed and the select committee set up, we can only try to seek the truth indirectly. But of course, in order to support the investigation into the truth, I'm going to support this motion. We have discussed the free television licenses a number of times, and we have repeated many arguments. So maybe I should repeat what I told my students on the 6th of November. In response to Mr. James Toh's motion, I pointed out that people have the right to use media. Under some conditions, they should ask the media, they can ask media to use the page or spectrum or program without payment. And now the Hong Kong government is restricting public access to media and to TV, undermining their interests. And our creative industry is declining, and our media is weaker. Since 1978, when commercial TV failed, we have had only two TV stations for so many years. And content providers find it difficult to get in touch with media consumers, and media consumers cannot have access to other programs not offered by the two TV stations, and they are weak. They cannot properly monitor the operation of the TV stations, so their interests have been ignored. Apart from media users, other parties are also adversely affected. The CA has ruled that TVB has ruled breached rules 13 and 14, and a fine of $900,000 was imposed, and TVB was ordered to provide a report in 4 months to indicate that the practice of TVB would be in breach of fair competition. TVB has restricted contract artists from appearing in other media, and thereby affecting the business of other media organizations and media use consumers. This is rarely seen in advanced media market, but it's ironic that we see this in a free market like Hong Kong, when the government announced its decision on the license, issuing the licenses, claiming that it was done to prevent cutthroat competition, and that new investors should be introduced gradually, because otherwise there will be a cutthroat competition, quality will decline, and the audience would suffer. Well, this is really laughable, because it comes from a government which has always valued itself as a free economy. If we look at this breakbulk operation, our laurel being the freest economy in the world is no longer appropriate. And there are secret media briefing on the causes of the Mr. Ricky Wong's failure. For example, Hong Kong TV network wants to operate many channels, and the advertisement revenue will not be able to sustain its operation. And this is just a flash in the pan, therefore it's not going to be sustainable. And also, according to the consultancy, we cannot support 5 stations. And TVB, in a program to quote bias information or allegation against Mr. Ricky Wong, claiming that Hong Kong TV network is not as good as Fantastic TV and Hong Kong television entertainment. So what is vicious competition? Is it because of the fresh in the pan style investment? I have looked up the ruling against TVB on fair competition. And the TVB actually quoted vicious competition in his defense. And the CA ruled that whether competition is vicious or not should play no role at all in the matter. Competition will bring about benefits, and the players concerned should compete as best they can, and there should be no stifling of competition. If there is vicious competition, it's the responsibility of the government, not private organizations. There's no definition on vicious competition, and it seems that the government seems to think that it has the final word on what is a vicious competition. I've read a few books on media competition, and I know the mainstream views in major economies. When the media sector is monopolized, then they would not be keen on innovation. Because of the concentration of the market, the media organizations would try to get a bigger market share. In order to compete for a bigger share, every media organization would try to please the majority, but they would not offer anything that would offend the minority. And by the products would become similar. And that's why the TV dramas are homogeneous. You have no choice. And you can see, for 3-time slots, you get the same thing. And the settings look similar from previous productions. And you become part of the captive audience. Media organizations will no longer be interested in innovation, quality suffer, and the media's influence would dwindle. On the contrary, if the market is shared by many organizations, no single one can monopolize the market, because monopolization is not cost-effective. So the best strategy is to explore niche market and gain a foothold in the market. When every market tries to get a niche, then we see a diversity of programs and quality programs. So from the perspective of safeguarding interests of the spectators, I'm concerned about the quality of programming, and I would like to get different needs satisfied by media organizations. According to the SAR government, the government is concerned whether the investor can recoup the investment, and if we have too many TV stations, some of them may collapse. In other words, the government is looking at this from the perspective of a media operator. Why is it that the government put the interests of a media organization before other media organizations or the consumers? What about the free market principle espoused by the government? And the free market is about competition, whereby both the consumer and the supplier would benefit. This is supposed to be fair, and therefore, and that means everyone would be fair in the competition. They would get a similar amount of market information, and which organization can enter or leave the market should not be up to the government. The power is in the hand of the consumer. The SAR government controls market access, thereby affected consumer's choice, disrupt the market order, it undermines the interests of the consumer and media organizations. And therefore, the government has got no one to blame but itself for this blunder. In the ITB panel meeting, we talk about a new broadcasting building of Hong Kong. And then RTHK, and the cost will be $6 billion. There will be 3 digital television channels. Some members are unhappy about the way the programming is done. And a member said that Mr. Ricky Wong was doomed to failure because of the much smaller investment. And also the director of broadcasting to exercise self-censorship, and RTHK is criticized to be a mouthpiece of the government. So it's, the RTHK is caught in the middle. The loyalists are saying that you are disrupting Hong Kong, and the Democrats are saying that you are guilty of self-censorship. What should RTHK do? It's going to cost $6 billion. The government has to explain why instead of 1.6 billion, it's 6 billion. And now we are saying that you are going to offer 3 terrestrial digital channels. It's tantamount to a new TV station. Secretary, the questions that you are going to face in the future is not just a free television licenses. You have been rehearsing the old points like a tape record. Well, you have Mr. C.Y. Leung to thank for that. And then the 2 free TV stations will have their new licenses renewed. Members are very unhappy about the dominant position of ATVB, and we are angry that the ATV is not doing anything good. So shouldn't we reject both renewal applications? So it's your problem. And also whether we should go ahead with the RTHK new building is your problem. Today's issue is relatively easy to handle. But when we look at the development of the broadcasting industries, there are many thorny issues and problems. And then in 2016, the commercial radio's license may present problems. A famous host has been redeployed. So there's a lot of tension in the media sector. Of course, our attention will be diverted by the constitutional reform issues. Can RTHK provide a diversity of program and news program to complement commercial operators? Well, there will be broadcasting ordinance regulating the operation. The owners of media organizations is not the government or the operators, but the consumers. These are my remarks.
Mr. Tam Yu Chong.
President, it's already very late, and I will not use all my 15 minutes, and I hope that I can end my speech by 12 midnight. I don't want to repeat what I said on the same subject last time. I just want to respond to the opening speech of Ms. Mo. She seemed to suggest the debate today would be sidelined by the political reform announcement and the Tai Long Sai Wan debate. But in fact, she only has herself to blame because she has chosen this time slot. She has chosen this date. Now, in fact, this issue has been discussed over a dozen times at various meetings of the LegCo. And in fact, earlier today, there was an oral question on this matter. So this matter has been thoroughly discussed. You know, the media and the public are showing less concern about this matter. So continuing to dwell on this matter amongst a waste of time. Now, Ms. Mo spoke for 15 minutes, and she, in her speech, criticized the ATV for not having submitted audited reports, and then she also criticized TVB for its dominant position. And then she said she was lucky that she was covered by the Powers and Privileges Ordinance, and as a result, she could say what she wanted to say. But being covered by the Powers and Privileges Ordinance doesn't mean that you really can make whatever what criticisms you want to. And then Ms. Mo said that Mr. Ambrose Ho, chairman of the CA, didn't dare to come to LegCo to tell his story because he was not covered by the PNP ordinance. But I've never heard Mr. Ho give such an explanation. But Mr. Ho has issued a written statement stating that he has already given the written account and has got nothing further to add. But then Ms. Mo said two times in her speech that in this present exercise there were problems with procedural justice. And Mr. So, the secretary, said that there was no problem with procedural justice at all. So what should we do in the light of such conflicting views? I understand that Mr. Ma Fung Kwok may seek a JR. So is it really better to leave the matter of procedural justice to the courts? In fact, the Civic Party advocates such an approach. The Civic Party likes to adopt this approach. But it seems that Ms. Claudia Mo has departed from the Civic Party's favorite approach, and I really feel rather surprised. Now, some pan-democrats earlier on frankly admitted that they repeatedly advocated the use of the Powers and Privileges Ordinance in order to keep the matter under the limelight. And even if this motion is defeated, they will continue to seek the use of the Powers and Privileges Ordinance to investigate other aspects of the incident, so that people will not people's interest in this matter will not decline. The DAB will not support this approach to continue to take advantage of this incident. The DAP opposes this motion. We now adjourn the sitting to 2:30 p.m. tomorrow.